Growing up in elementary school specifically, me, my two brothers, my two cousins, we get picked up every day by our grandparents and would be taken to their house after school. Our other grandparents lived in Indiana at this time, and it was just a huge help for my parents, as you can imagine, for their kids to be picked up. Free childcare. Can I get a what on that one? So every day we would get picked up, we'd be taken to their house, and the afternoon would always begin in their kitchen. We get home, we get to their house, we get the snack for the day. Oftentimes it consisted of things that were barely palatable for us as little ones, including bananas with peanut butter and mayonnaise on them. Is that a thing for you all? Yeah, I sit in judgment of our grandparents about that one. Nasty, nasty, force-fed it. Force-fed oatmeal as well. Who likes oatmeal? Not many. Yeah, you're weird. Texture, it's bad. But we would go there every day. And this table became a central part of our life growing up. It became a place where we had the snack. It's where we had played games, where we lived in community. It's also a place where we were kind of taught how to pray in forceful ways. We were taught, you know, you will not do that in my house. All those good things that you lived through growing up. I think it shaped us okay. I'm so worried about some of my brothers. But it was a central gathering place. And it's a place that at sometimes we would actually put together little wooden figures of insects, and we go door to door in the neighborhood. We paint them and then we sell them to them. Then we go to East Bay. You remember that magazine back in the day? We got custom made jerseys for our driveway basketball team of the five cousins from that, like going door to door. This was before, you know, it was before what you see online. And so we were going door to door. It was an awesome time. Really a kind of a sacred space, that table became. Formed us, formed memories for us, connected us to each other, connected us in ways that created bonds that will, you know, really last forever. And now as an adult, as a husband and a dad, it's a table that we still go back to every now and then. So when we visit my grandparents there, we sit at that same table in some of the same chairs that I grew up in. And now they're loving on my kids, and we're sharing new memories and having a good time together. It's really kind of this sacred, special place that's just full of memories. In many of our homes, the table is just a significant place. It's the significant place in every home. As you saw on our kind of bumper video for this series, it's a place where you eat, you gather, you fold clothes. It's where you throw all your stuff at the end of a day. It's a place of family, of community. It's a place of arguing over who's winning the latest board game or cheating at Monopoly if you're like our family. Terrible, terrible. Never, if you're trying to repair things relationally, don't bring out board games, specifically Monopoly. That's how it works in our world. You know there's a cheater's edition? This is true. You know there's a cheater's edition of Monopoly now? They've actually created a game geared towards cheaters. If you buy that, take a hard look in the mirror. I'm just saying. But this table in our homes, it's a significant, significant space. It's where we enjoy conversation, maybe where you pay your bills and you plan things, if planning is still a thing at the moment. In many ways, the table acts as this central gathering point, a rallying point, a call to community, a call to support when things feel broken, a place of advice, place of friendship, place of love, place more than food, but the meaning and the message that takes place there. And we experience that physically in our homes, in other people's homes, here together. But even beyond that, I've said this before, but internally there's kind of this space that we have as well. In fact, you are made with an internal space where you are meant to interact with God and even process your life. Familiar with that language of like you have an angel on one shoulder, the bad one on the other? I mean, you know, kind of interesting thought. But I like to think of it like if we could take the magic bus ride, is that the cartoon from the day? Go interior to kind of like that soul level of our bodies. Like there is this space that the way God created us is where we kind of have that internal dialogue. It's where the things that we're struggling with kind of become a conversation internally. And for much of church history, there's been this image of God the Father, God the Son, God the Spirit, pictured as if three persons sitting at a table with an open chair. It's a picture of the community and the connection and the relationship that God, the Father, Son, and Spirit have in themselves, but it's never pictured closed off. It's pictured with an open seat. The good news about this table, this inward table, as it really reflects the way we practice community at the table in our lives, is that there is always an open invitation to meet with God at the table. To find a place where you can bring your hurts, where you can bring your struggles, where you can have some PG-13 maybe rated prayers with God. Ever been there? Where you can have some open, honest conversation. Where you can hear things from him and exchange emotions and change viewpoints and change perspective in the best way. And I think one of the most difficult things that we've all faced in these last months, and I don't want to harp on there, you hear enough about this, but I think one of the most difficult things has been the lack of ability to connect and be together, to have true community without the safeguards, without the masks, without the do we elbow or shake or hug or who's comfortable with us. One of the good news about this reality is that there is always community and connection available at the table in an inward space that God has already hardwired into you. A table itself, it was always consistently at the center of important moments even in the life of Jesus. I don't know this, but I speculate. Jesus as a carpenter, I imagine he built some tables in his life. I would imagine a good woodworker would do that. Jesus was also constantly eating with people in their homes. He was eating with, the language of Scripture, sinners, the lost, sick people. Let's put it in art, like the misfits and the outcasts, the broken, the people that maybe were on different socioeconomic tiers. He broke past all that. And he was constantly at tables with people. Tables with people that were in his circle and tables with people that he was trying to invite into a life of more meaning and help and peace and hope and purpose. He was constantly sitting at tables that the leaders of the time thought were taboo. That you shouldn't be with those people. If you're a rabbi, a Jewish teacher, if you who you say you are, you do not belong with those people. Jesus always turned that on his heels and said, I will go to your house. Come and be with me. Meet me at the table. We just came out of this series on the Sabbath, and the table is a central part of the practice of Sabbath in that day as well. In fact, Jesus was consistently, and we'll see in our scripture for today, that he was getting in trouble with some of the religious folk because of what he would do at the table on the Sabbath. The table is a central part of Jesus' life. He flipped the tables in the temple, if you're familiar with that story. He literally got a little, you know, righteous anger and said, this shall not happen, and he did his thing, and he flipped the tables. Jesus spoke of this table that we're all invited to as this language of a great banquet, this eternal banquet, this feast that all of us will be part of us forever as we apprentice with Jesus. It's coming at that new creation that I talked about a few weeks ago. Jesus sat at one of the most meaningful tables ever in the upper room, where just before he came to kind of culminate his life's mission through the cross and the resurrection and then the coming of the Holy Spirit to bring us in movement and power and mission to today, he sat and he broke. He sat and he broke bread with them and he drank from the cup and told them, as often in the future, what I'm about to do, do this in remembrance of me. Jesus constantly spoke about a banquet or a table in some of his parables. Are you catching on that a theme of the table is a central part of Jesus' life and an invitation that we all share? It's interesting because the table is a radically ordinary place. Putting together this idea of radically ordinary is an interesting thought, and here's why. That it is so routine and everyday, it is easily overlooked as a place of life-changing community. The history of the movement that you and I belong to, the church, the mission of God, the people of God, is around a table. It's before this table where we remember what God did for us. It's in one another's homes. For hundreds of years, the table in the early Christians' homes was the place that this message of Jesus and the way of Jesus exploded and went from Jerusalem to the rest of the world and now lands in our laps, and we are sitting at kind of this greater table. How did that happen? How does that happen? You know, maybe you have a similar experience to what I had with my grandparents, that a table sets the context for you to feel loved, it's a place for you to feel heard, it's a place for you to feel known. It's a place where God's Spirit can move and speak to you and join you with people inside your circle and outside your circle that brings peace and healing and mission and purpose and hope to your life. In today's story that we're going to use to frame this series for the next few weeks, Jesus was once again sitting at a table in someone's home that actually was kind of a bit of a setup. He was in community, again, with literally anyone and everyone that he could bring to the table. And here's where the story picks up for us in Luke chapter 14. It says this, one Sabbath, stop there. If you were tracking with us in August, you would know that probably because Jesus is in someone's home on the Sabbath, that they're coming after him. And that's exactly what was about to happen. When Jesus went to eat in the house of a prominent Pharisee, he was being carefully watched. Why? Because there was rules, there was laws, there was things he was not supposed to do on the Sabbath. And there in front of him, here's the test, was a man suffering from abnormal swelling of his body. Jesus asked the Pharisees and the experts in the law, is it lawful to heal on the Sabbath or not? As in, watch what I'm about to do. But they remained silent. I mean, because picture this, he's kind of setting them up in their setup. He's Jesus juking them really hard right back at you. I raise you this question, you've set me up. And Jesus saying, are we seriously not going to heal this man because there's some arbitrary rule against it? They remain silent. So taking hold of the man, he healed him and sent him on his way. So he heals him in the house of the Pharisee who is the host. He's going against the host's rules. Ever been invited to someone's house and the host's rules are maybe a little different than they are at your house, and you get that awkward glance as you're still wearing your shoes on the carpet and you didn't do the customary things there? I get that glare about every day when I get in my house because it's one of those rules I can't seem to get into my head. Working on it, y'all pray for us. So the story continues. He kind of rebukes the Pharisees and he tells them a story about this host, this banquet. Then he picks up again. Then Jesus said to this host, when you give a luncheon or dinner, do not invite your friends, your brothers or sisters, your relatives or your rich neighbors. If you do, they may invite you back so you will be repaid. Now picture, Jesus is saying, don't be like the Real Housewives of Orange County. Don't invite them to the house, throw an amazing house party, be the host, and then the other person's like, well, I'm going to invite you all, I'm going to one-up you. You did this, I'm going to do this, it's going to be better. So that's essentially what he's saying to these religious sociolites. That's not, socialites, maybe they're a little sociolite, I don't know. Socialites saying, there's more to this invitation than I'm about to teach you. So don't do these house parties just to show off the house and your party. But when you give a banquet, invite the poor, the crippled, the lame, the blind, and you will be blessed. Although they cannot repay you, you will be repaid at the resurrection of the righteous. I'm not going to camp here, even though I want to. This whole idea of repayment at the resurrection of the righteous. Watch the message a few weeks ago when we talked about this eternal new creation. This is what he's talking about. Do it for the inbreaking, this forever kingdom thing. Got to move on. Then Jesus said all that to his host. But when one of them at the table with him heard this, he said to Jesus, blessed is the one who will eat at the feast in the kingdom of God. Blessed is the one who will eat at the table, this forever feast in the kingdom of God. Again, so Jesus Jesus kind of Jesus jukes the host in the question earlier, and then one of the people in the room does it almost right back at him and says, ho, I think I know what's going on here. I know what you're saying. Blessed is the one who will eat at the feast in the kingdom of God. It's like all the teachers in the room, it's that kid that's trying to beat everyone else to the right answer. Jesus hasn't even finished his story, his parable. This guy's getting his words in. He's kind of right, but then Jesus, in typical Jesus fashion, is not really ready to give up the bottom line yet. So here's what he says next. Jesus replied, a certain man was preparing a great banquet. And I just picture like the nod, nod, wink, wink. I'm looking at you, host, and all you people. A certain man was preparing a great banquet and invited many guests. At the time of the banquet, he sent his servant to tell those who had been invited, come, for everything is now ready. And in this time of history, if you hosted a dinner party, you would send the invite out, but the time frame would be kind of blank. People lived in close proximity. They weren't driving between towns with the car. So if you hosted a house party, it was mainly for your neighbors, the people that were like you. So they say, hey, come over next Saturday, and then I'll send a servant to tell you when. Just be ready. And if you said yes, you better hold your yes. Let your yes be yes in this culture, or it's going to be bad for you. All right? So that's kind of what's happening behind the scenes. But at the time of the banquet, he sent his servant to tell those who had been invited, come, for everything is ready. This is like the ancient equivalent of the Facebook notification for your event that says, hey, you said yes to this event. It starts in 10 minutes. Reminder, you better get there. And here's what he goes on to say. But they all alike began to make excuses. So everyone that had been invited, everyone that said yes last week, began to make excuses. The first said, I've just bought a field and I must go and see it. Please excuse me. Lame. Another said, I have just bought 5 yoke of oxen and I'm on my way to try them out. Please excuse me. Also lame, who buys 5 yoke of oxen and doesn't try them out beforehand. That's just poor money management. Still another said, I just got married so I can't come. Now this one I give a little bit of credit to, but I think he was really just throwing his wife under the bus. But still another said, I just got married, so I can't come. The servant came back and reported this to his master. Then the owner of the house became angry and ordered his servant, go out quickly into the streets and alleys of the town and bring in the poor, the crippled, the blind, and the lame. Sir, the servant said, what you ordered has been done, but there is still more room. Then the master told his servant, go out to the roads, go a little bit farther to the country lanes and compel them to come in so that my house will be full. I tell you, not one of those who are invited will get a taste of my banquet. Quite the dinner party, right? You're like, I thought you were talking about Jesus as this really invitational guy. It sounds like he just went to someone else's house party and really rebuked them the whole time. Maybe a little bit. And I would be interested to have been there, to see the reactions, feel the tension in the room as Jesus is basically saying, listen, you're wrong. You're way wrong. Here's the right way to do this. And so here's what I want to do for our remaining few minutes. Looking at this story, I want to give you 3 thoughts that will frame our next few weeks together at the table that will help us to see more about the table that you and I are invited to and what really that means for us. So here's the first thought. The table, this place of community that Jesus invites you to, will last forever. Will last forever. Have you ever been to a bad party that you just couldn't get out of fast enough? Been there? Have you ever thrown that party? How would you know, right? It just ended really fast for some reason. But you couldn't get out of it fast enough. But have you ever been to a party or to a gathering that before you knew it, it had been 5 hours down the road and you had no idea and you're just having the most incredible time with people, good food, conversation, games. I hate group games at parties. Don't ever make me do that. If you invite me, we will come. But games, no thank you, love you, mean it. So is anyone there? Who's the group games people in the room? Group games? All right. Look at each other. Invite each other, leave the rest of us out of it, all right? So let me take you back to one particular moment. Luke 14:15, back from this story. Let's go back. Remember the guy that's kind of trying to please Jesus? Here's what he says. Well, one of those at the table with him heard this. He said to Jesus, "Blessed is the one who will eat at the feast in the kingdom of God." Who will eat? Who will eat there? There's a lot of meaning behind this idea. There's symbolism that goes backwards towards like this, the Passover meal and this table that was so important, this feast that the Jews celebrated, that really was a symbol of what was to come in Jesus as the forgiveness of sin and the gospel message, this hopeful of this Messiah. But this also looks forward. It looks forward to this forever banquet, this forever party that God invites us to. In fact, the prophet Isaiah talked about it this way. He said, "On the mountain, the Lord Almighty will prepare a feast of rich food." For who? For all peoples. Get your invitations right, is what he's saying. For all peoples. A banquet of aged wine, the best of meats, and the finest of wines. On this mountain, he will destroy the shroud that enfolds all peoples, the sheet that covers all nations. He will swallow up death forever. The sovereign Lord will wipe away the tears from all faces. He will remove his people's disgrace from all the earth. And then we talked about it earlier, this Last Supper where Jesus is breaking the bread and inviting them to remember this forever. Right after he does that moment, he says this, "I tell you, I will not drink from this fruit of the vine from now on until that day when I drink it new with you in my Father's kingdom." Even Jesus, right now, is waiting in a hopeful anticipation of this forever dinner party that you and I are invited to. He's waiting with anticipation for your arrival, for others' arrival at this forever dinner party with made with the best of meats and wines and all the end of suffering that you can imagine, where he's going to wipe away death and harm and fear and everything that we struggle with right now. He's ready and waiting and anticipating till he can celebrate that with you and me. John in the book of Revelation speaks of it this way. He says, "Then I heard what sounded like a great multitude, like the roar of rushing waters and the like loud peals of thunder, shouting, 'Hallelujah, for our Lord God Almighty reigns. Let us rejoice and be glad and give him glory. For the wedding of the Lamb has come and his bride has made herself ready. Fine linen, bright and clean, was given her to wear.' Then the angel said to me," this is to John, "'write this, blessed are those who are invited to the wedding supper of the Lamb.' And he added, 'These are the true words of God.'" In other words, this table that you and I are invited to is really, really good. It is really, really good news, not just then, but it's really good news for now. Imagine one day that there will be an end to all the suffering that we embrace, all the suffering of the world, all the suffering that you are experiencing right now. Imagine an end to all injustice and poverty and division and hatred. Imagine an end to all anxiety and depression and hurry and hunger and addiction and death and sickness and racism and loneliness. Put anything on your list. Imagine an end to that and then live there forever. And let God bring us to a table together with people from all of history, of every nation and culture and background and experience on this planet, to a new earth, a new chance at life, at the greatest party that you've ever experienced. The table that we're invited to will last forever, and it puts an end to every evil and darkness that you've ever experienced. Think about the people that you know that are just struggling, even if that struggle doesn't change in this life. There's a table. There's a table. And there's a chair waiting for them. There's a chair waiting for you. And it lasts forever. Forever. Darkness is gone. And the brightness of the Son of God and the light that breaks through will never go away. It will never fade on your life. And the greatest food and conversation and playing Monopoly without cheaters will last forever. Maybe not the Monopoly, that can stay down here. Here's the second thought about the table. The table that Jesus invites you to is inclusive. It is inclusive. That's going to be our focus next week. We're going to talk about how the table is a place that ends injustice. It's a table that is inclusive of all people. It's a table where everyone is invited and that we are part of being included in something that is bigger than us. And it spans gaps that won't and can't and just aren't being closed on this earth in its natural form. But it can be through the way that you and I live. I remember something unique about my grandparents' table is that obviously this table was in their home. And they were like many of you, I can look around and look, meet eyes with some of you. Their table just wasn't a place of inclusion. Their home was a place of inclusion. I can't tell you how many times we go and they'd be like, there'd be kind of a new person in their life that was living with them temporarily. That they were opening their home and saying, come on in, come on in. You're in need, I've got a roof, I've got shelter, come in, you're invited. In this parable, there's more to the meaning than the fact that those who were invited turned the invitation down. They didn't turn the invitation down just out of inconvenience. They turned the invitation down because they thought that they should only be sitting at the table with people just like them. The table that God invites us to, the table that you and I get to sit at, is a place that is extended equally to every person on this planet throughout any moment in history. You and I don't have to look far right now to see intense division. You don't have to look far. You don't have to look far to see it, to maybe feel it. But there's a place, there's a seat, there is a table where all that will go away. And it can go away now to the extent that it will refocus our hearts and our relationships on the things that are so much deeper. That there are issues that we are struggling with, and division over elections and division over so many things that are really distractions from us sitting at the table together. They're distractions. And can I just give you a piece of quick advice? Those things aren't going to end. Your rant, my rant, one side, the other side, everyone's right in their mind. It's not going to end. You know where it will end? At the table. And you know where it can at least get beneath that and above it and around it and frame our lives in a way that looks beyond that and looks to the heart and lives with love, not division? It's at the table. The way of Jesus is constantly building and filling a bigger table, and so should you. The way of Jesus constantly created more room, more space, more invitation, more openness. And if you're practicing the way of Jesus and you're doing it with division instead of love, can I say you're missing the point of the table? Can I just say it? You're missing the point of the table. And if you're practicing the way of Jesus, but you're kind of sitting at the table with your elbows up, kind of protecting what's yours and your space, and trying to have the best outfit at the table and have the best plate and the best seat at the table, you're also kind of missing the point. And I don't say that in judgment. I say that to lift us to a new way of interacting with God, with each other, and with the very people that God has put in our lives and in our community and in our families, in our neighborhoods, to get to this table. We have to be a community. We have to be a community that figures out and fights to put purpose over preference, because purpose makes more room by building a bigger table, and preference stays busy saving seats. Let me say that again. We, you, us together need to be a community. We have to be a community. We need to be this community that fights to put purpose over preference every time, because purpose makes more room by building a bigger table, and preference stays busy by saving seat. Save a seat by creating more chairs. Save a seat by making more space. Save a seat by adding another 4,000 feet to this table. Save another seat by inviting people to the table in your homes, in your living rooms. Save a seat by being in community with people that puts purpose over preference. And, you know, we'll help shape what that purpose is. And you may not love everything that kind of feeds into what we're saying is on purpose, and that's okay. But let's focus our hearts on what really matters. Everything that we do as a community and together and in your lives, and the way that we hope for the years and years and years to come to empower you personally and together to create a bigger table is on purpose. And the goal is more room, more people, more connection, more people knowing and finding hope and life in the real Jesus, not us creating the nicest customized seat and where it's exclusive and it is limited. Not what we're about. And I don't think it's what you're about. I don't think it's what you want to be about. So then, if this is the challenge of Jesus, and this was kind of what he was saying to these Pharisees, why, and if this was really how the Christian movement exploded from table to table, from home to home, why isn't this as much the norm now? First of all, there are areas in this world right now, we have a very limited perspective, it's exploding. In some of the countries and cultures that are the most closed, hostile, oppressive to the Christian faith, where it's been buried and put underground, the Christian movement is exploding and growing. It is not all an American perspective on the church. The church of Jesus Christ is healthy. It is growing. And it's an invitation to us to take our seat and to build a bigger table in our context to reach more people here. But why isn't this the norm? Let me take you back to what the servant experienced when he went to gather people for the table. A certain man was preparing this banquet, invited many guests. Come, for everything is now ready. But they all alike began to make excuses. They began to make excuses. I'm going to invite the team to come back up, and we're going to sing our way out of here today. Is that all right with you? It's been a few minutes since we've been together this way. How about we have a little bit more time in worship together? But they're going to come back up. This brings me to my final point, that the table Jesus invites you to is where you belong. It's where you belong without excuse. It's where you belong regardless of the obstacle that you face. And it makes me wonder, what's the difference historically now for us in this room? What's the difference in the person that sees this invitation and responds by way of excuse or responds by way of this is an opportunity to seize and to live in? I think it boils down to one idea. And this is a tough idea for us. It's tough in our culture, it's tough in our context. It's tough because many of us, comparatively, live a pretty comfortable life. I think it boils down to an awareness of our need. An awareness of our need. The guy, when he went back to Jesus, he said, "Blessed is the one who sits at the feast in the kingdom of God." To be blessed, to receive this good gift from God, to receive the invitation and take your place at the table, only happens if you're aware of your need to be there. It only happens if we're aware of our own struggle, if we're aware of our own problems. Have you ever tried to give a gift to someone that just wouldn't take it? How annoying is that? So annoying. So annoying. And I wonder how often that is God's experience. Where he says, "I've laid out this banquet. I've laid out this table. And I am constantly sending you an invitation. I'm sending it to you by way of nice, snazzy videos on Facebook. I'm sending it to you by way of your friends and your church family. I'm sending it by way of my spirit and through my scripture. I'm sending it by way of a song lyric. I'm sending it through so many ways trying to get your attention, and it's hard for us to hear it because we're not aware of our need." Something I've been thinking about and praying about a lot lately, just to let you in on the inside of where I've been a little bit, is I wonder how much of, can we just say, obsessive negativity we've experienced for 6 months? I wonder how much of the division that we're experiencing, politics, sports, I mean, you name it, and I don't want to get into it. I wonder how much of that. I wonder how much of the division over way to handle the current circumstances. I wonder how much of that has to do with this question. That is it possible we're actually missing the point of this cultural moment? Is it possible that there's a greater meaning, an invitation that God's inviting us to that has nothing to do with COVID or schools, in person, out of person, collar scheme, politics, race, that has nothing to do with any of that? But it's really an invitation to come take a seat at the table and repent of the ways that we've been doing our own thing based on our comfort and our money and our cultural norms for so long. Maybe we're missing the point. And God's inviting us to a table that begins with some repentance, begins with some awareness of our need. Because I gotta tell you, the table that God invites you to as an individual is the same table that is available to everyone on this planet. There's not an American table or a white table or a Taze Valley table or a rich table or a poor table. It's one thing. Blessed is the one who eats at the feast of the kingdom of God. Blessed is the one that's invited to this forever wedding supper, this banquet that we are invited to. What if the moment we're experiencing is a wake-up call to realize our need, that we've built our lives on things that are ultimately temporary? They matter, and they're worth giving our best effort. And I am not minimizing any of that. There are people in this room, myself included, that are agonizing over decisions on the daily as a result of what we're walking through. I'm not minimizing that. But I want to ask, as a group of apprentices of Jesus sitting at a table together with the goal to make a bigger table with more chairs and more seats and more inclusion, if there's something underneath all of this that can center our hearts on the reality that God and this table and his life and his way is what we need. And it's the only way that we'll have a path forward. So let me end with this direct thought to you. Don't shrink Jesus down to a seat at your table. Take your customized seat at his. Maybe we've been creating our own tables and we've said, God, you can have this one over here. Sorry, cameras. You can take this one over here. I'm gonna sit at the kind of the power seat, and I'm gonna invite who I want. And you may move closer to me at times and further away based on what I kind of wanna do, based on kind of the struggle I'm walking through. And that's part of life. I'm not minimizing that. And we all have our journey there. But maybe the switch that needs to happen is, as we consider what the table is that Jesus has invited us to, is to start with this question. Whose table are you sitting at? Is it your own or is it his? Because one is temporary and one will be filled with a lot more struggle than is necessary. This one will still have struggle, but it has power with it, has perspective with it. It has foreverlasting community. And as we sing about Jesus, you alone, Jesus alone is our path forward. So why don't you stand? We're going to sing this chorus in just a second. I'm going to pray for us now. And I want you to consider from your seat, where you are, you want to come talk to me over on the side, talk afterwards. This is just a moment of honest reflection as we sing together. And it gives us a chance to consider the table that we are sitting at. Let me pray for us. Father, thank you that your invitation that was clear to the people in that room all those years ago is in this room now. That in this moment you saw fit to bring us together in the room and online, local and from distance. You saw fit to bring us together. We're not here by accident. We're not here because we were an afterthought, but we were thought of before the foundations of the earth. God, I pray that you'll help people in this moment, in the weeks to come, through conversation, through repentance, through prayer, through whatever it means, that we will get our seat at the right table with you, and that we begin to practice your way in a way, in such a way that it changes our life and it recalibrates our relationships and our emotions and our mind. I pray that in this moment you'll begin to lift people out of anxiety and depression and worry and fear and all the things that are plaguing our hearts and mind. I pray that you'll help us to be passionate about the things that we should be passionate about. I pray that you'll help us to be inclusive towards others, to bring them to this table. But I pray right now for those that need to make a step towards getting at your table. Will you settle that in their heart right now? Will you settle that in their mind? And for the person that maybe just kind of pulled the chair back a little bit, would you just inch them closer? Inch them closer. Help someone that's at the seat beside them to pull them closer, to bring them in. God, I pray that as we sing, you do what only you can do. In your name we pray.